Imagine you could just rearrange some genes and create a climate-smart banana, rice that needs less water, or a potato to reduce food waste. Well, it's all become possible thanks to genome editing, or CRISPR, as you might know it. The current way we produce food is taking a huge toll on the environment. But how to produce more without harming the planet further?
So the food system is probably the greatest challenge to nature and biodiversity on this planet.
Scientists are coming up with ever more super crops that are more productive and even climate resilient. But is it really a good idea? We started improving plants by crossbreeding the best varieties with each other. The first records of humans selecting ancient grass and wheat dates back to 10,000 years ago. Since then, we've multiplied corn, wheat, rice, and soy yields by several times and bred them to something which would probably be hard to identify for one of the early settlers back then. For example, do you know what this is? Today it looks like this. Doesn't really seem like a close relative, does it? In the past decades, yields have literally skyrocketed. In India alone, rice, wheat, and corn yields have doubled or tripled since 1940. But while millions have profited, these gains still come at a price today. To feed an ever-increasing population, we did not stop at just multiplying yields. Our excessive use of fertilizers, pesticides, and the ongoing conversion of sensitive ecosystems to cropland have degraded 40% of fertile soils globally, making farming a gigantic challenge in the future. And on top of that, the climate crisis is forecast to reduce harvests in the best case by 3% and the worst by 12% by 2050. And here's the problem, we actually need to produce more without using more land and resources.
There's a 50% gap between the food produced today and what we need in 2050 just to feed people adequately.
This is Jeanette Ranganathan, co-author of the Future of Food Report by the World Resource Institute, a US-based NGO. If everyone in the world switched to a vegetarian diet, we could produce enough, sustainably, but that doesn't look like it'll be happening anytime soon.
If we just stick at the current yield rate and say, oh, it's great, let's pat ourselves on the back and move on, then the only way that we would meet those needs is to expand the agricultural frontier even further, which means sort of goodbye to the remaining natural ecosystems.
Scientists are working on designing climate-resilient super crops that might produce higher yields and need less resources to grow. But they don't do it the classic way, by crossbreeding. They want to speed up the process by changing the plant's genetic code using a method called genome editing. For example, in rice. Drought was all over the news this summer.
It is brutal down there.
Drought emergency.
Unprecedented droughts and heat waves have put water scarcity into sharp focus.
And that's a problem for rice, a very thirsty crop used to being bathed in water. Over half of the world's population eats rice as a staple food. But record-breaking droughts from southern Europe to India, Pakistan, and China had huge impacts on harvests. A new rice bread might help here in the future. This variety, named IR64, is mostly grown in the global south, but lands on plates globally. By tweaking its genes, scientists succeeded in making the variety more drought resistant. This new rice uses up to 40% less water in some weeks compared to its mother plant. While the conventional varieties did not survive a week without water in 40 degree heat, half of the gene-edited plants survived. How did they do that? In a nutshell, scientists instructed a naturally occurring gene in the plant to be more powerful. This gene is involved in reducing the number and size of the plant's pores, which are responsible for the plant's gas and water exchange. Fewer and smaller pores meant the plant saved water, yields increased or remained the same. The method they used here is called CRISPR-Cas9, also known as genetic scissors or genome editing. It is fundamentally different to traditional genetic modification or GM technologies.
It relies actually on natural processes, but it makes the mutation process much less random.
This is Detlef Weigel. He's working on making crops more pest-resistant at the Max Planck Institute in Tübingen, Germany. Most GM products contain a synthetic gene or a gene from another organism inserted into the plant or animal of interest. Insect-resistant cotton and maize, for example, which are widely grown around the world, contain a gene originally found in bacteria. Instead of using foreign DNA, gene editing makes changes in the characteristics of any organism using the information present in its own genetic code. Using special enzymes working like scissors, we can delete, swap, or repeat genes present in the plant's DNA.
Mutations are actually frequent enough that essentially any mutation that you can induce in the laboratory will also occur in nature. It will take many dozens of generations until you have only this one gene transferred by crossing. And that often will not be very viable because it would just take too long. So their genome editing is really super powerful because you can go in the single gene, change it, and voila.
With crossbreeding, it takes between 7 and 15 years until you have a plant with the desired trait. Editing genes just takes a couple of months. The test phase may be a couple of years. It's much more precise and desired traits can be targeted directly. Whereas in crossbreeding, the wanted and unwanted characteristics are all being combined with each other. Around the world, research on genetically editing crops has sped up drastically. From only a couple of patents filed in 2011 to about 2,000 patents in 2019 by private companies and public researchers. The US, China, but also multinational companies are investing heavily into the technology, which is expected to develop into a multi-billion dollar market by the end of the decade. And it's not only about drought-resistant rice. There have been successful studies on how to increase tomato crop yields by up to 70%. Others try to make soybeans grow better in degraded and salty soils and reduce methane emissions in rice. And Kenyan scientists are developing a smart banana, as they call it. In their laboratory, they managed to activate a gene to preventively turn on the plant's own immune system against a virus that becomes active with drought. 75% of their plants became resistant. Other scientists have developed semi-dwarf banana plants, which are supposed to be more resilient against heavy storms because they are less likely to topple over. But of course, there is risk involved.
If you do a genome edit, you change one gene that interacts with the thousands of other genes in the genome, there are many fewer interactions that can go wrong. Whereas in crosses, again, thousands of genes you combine, genome editing should be less dangerous than white crosses.
It's a controversial opinion, especially due to the fact that many of the new varieties of crops are still in the research phases and there is very little data and risk assessments available.
It's going to be experimentation that will take place in the field.
This is Maria Mayet. She's been advocating against the genetic manipulation of plants for years.
And we're going to then have to see what happens in nature. It's all uncertain and it will be really experimentation that will be far ahead of the science. The science will have to catch up.
Some experts point to cases of off-target genetic changes or cases of deleting much more genetic information than intended. In the case of an oil crop, a plant's communication system was damaged, which in nature could have destroyed its natural defense against pests and potentially impacted an entire ecosystem. Despite all the hype and its potential, the method is still very new and companies are struggling to deliver. Globally, there are only very few crops currently on the market, among them a soybean and a tomato variety. But what about staple crops?
Maize and wheat, I'm a lot more skeptical how useful genome editing they are, is because, again, so they have been subject of all this intensive breeding. They are highly optimized. So just to find single genes that make a big difference is really, really difficult.
Additionally, genes involved in increasing yields in some type of drought could decrease yields in wet years. And as there is a large number of genes involved, turning one or two genes on or off is mostly not enough here. The less optimized the crop, the easier it is to improve. That's why experts see most potential in quickly developing old varieties that haven't been part of industrial production so far. For example, species like millet, einkorn wheat or yucca, which already have stronger defenses against climate-related challenges, but where breeding is still in its infancy and the potential for quick yield increases is high.
We can very quickly bring those crops to a place where they're agronomically feasible to use and therefore start to diversify our food system further.
This is William Pelton. He's the CEO of Phytoform, a UK startup developing new crops primarily for the US and Australian market. With the help of artificial intelligence, Phytoform tries to detect even more opportunities for optimization. Their algorithms can process in a short time amounts of data for which a single human would need years. Today, some algorithms are essentially understanding DNA better than humans.
So it can start to spot regions that are repeated and therefore start to derive meaning. And of course, that means it can then understand the DNA, but then it can also suggest changes that could be made in order to affect an outcome.
One crop they are working on is a potato that doesn't turn brown when damaged, which is supposed to reduce food waste. Another one is called lupin, a crop which has been in use for thousands of years, but has not been part of big business so far. Low yields or quality issues can now be overcome with the help of algorithms pinpointing to what needs to be done to improve their performance. Lupin is very high in protein and nutrients and could be used in plant-based meat. It is considered to be more tolerant to acidic soils compared to other veggies, and some varieties are also fairly drought resistant. Phytoform hopes to bring their first crops to market in 2 to 3 years. But enough beating around the bush. We have the opportunity to engineer plants even further to fit our needs, but is it enough to meet the increasing food demand and spare our ecosystems at the same time?
These are false solutions. It'll give us a temporary quick fix for a couple of years, but it's not going to obviate social inequities, the environmental problems.
There are risks with this technology, but there are also risks from biodiversity, you know, from climate change, from hunger. So those are all the risks. Those are the cards that are on the table that we need to deal with here. So I don't want to take anything off the table. The challenge is so significant. I don't want to take CRISPR technology off. I don't want to take shifting diets. I don't want to take restoration or reducing. It's all of these things.
In the EU, genetically edited crops are labeled GM and therefore forbidden. But there's increasing discussion about whether the GM label is still appropriate, or if genome editing should be considered a new breeding method instead of classic genetic manipulation, which is creating entirely artificial organisms. In the US, China, and many Latin American countries, genome-edited crops don't need to be labeled or controlled as GM, and the sector is set to bring a number of crops to the fields in the coming years. India also decided to ease its regulation this year. As highly advanced as genome editing methods might be, conventional breeding will remain as important. Neither of them will be able to make up for the huge burden we currently put on our ecosystems, but they'll probably have their role in filling the food gap in the future.
What's your opinion? Let us know in the comments. Like the video, subscribe to our channel. We have new videos for you every Friday.